Kia ora team, welcome back to the 2.5 Genetic Variation and Change video series. This is video 6. In this video, you'll be learning about monohybrid crosses, test crosses, and pedigree charts. And by the end of this lesson, you should be able to use Punnett squares to predict the result of monohybrid crosses, identify the expected phenotypic and genotypic ratios of monohybrid crosses using Punnett squares, and explain the usefulness of test crosses in determining the genotype of a given individual. And finally, you should be able to use pedigree charts to identify the probable genotype or phenotypes of a given individual. Before we can get into discussing monohybrid crosses and Punnett squares, we must first learn some new vocabulary. The first word we're going to learn about is cross or crossing. When you cross something, it means you mate two individuals. And usually this mating is represented by an X, as shown in this picture. The second word you're going to learn about is purebred or truebred. A purebred or a truebred individual is a homozygous individual, and they can either be homozygous dominant or homozygous recessive. The third word is hybrid. A hybrid individual is a heterozygous individual. And we get these hybrid individuals by mating two true breeding varieties, or mating two purebred varieties. So to get this hybrid purple plant, they mated the truebred purple plant and the white truebred plant. These next three words are to do with the generations of individuals involved in a breeding experiment. The P, or parental generation, refers to the true breeding parents that were initially mated. So they're like the parent population, the starting points you have in a breeding experiment. The F1, or the first filial generation, refers to the first generation of offspring produced from the parent. If those F1 generation individuals are then self-pollinated or mated together, then their offspring would be called the F2, or the second filial generation. Filial is a word derived from the Latin word for son, like as in son and daughter. So filial represents generations of offspring from the parental generation. Before we get into monohybrid crosses, I just want to say something about crosses in general. Crosses, so mating two individuals together, are used by geneticists, people who study genetics, to study the inheritance patterns of certain traits or genes. It's really important to understand how traits or genes are inherited, because let's say, you know, farmers who want to raise livestock, or scientists or doctors studying genetic diseases, want to track both favorable and harmful traits and alleles. In 2.5, we'll be studying several types of crosses. These are monohybrid crosses and test crosses that we'll cover in this video, and also dihybrid crosses, which we'll cover in a future video. You already learned about monohybrid crosses in Year 11 Genetics. A monohybrid cross is a type of cross where two individuals are mated, but only one trait is followed in subsequent generations. For example, the height of pea plants is controlled by a single gene which has two alleles, tall and dwarf. The tall allele is dominant and is shown by the big T, and the dwarf allele is recessive and is shown by the small t. Geneticists found out that tall was dominant and dwarf was recessive through the use of monohybrid crosses to study just this one gene. And a tool they used to study this gene in monohybrid crosses is the Punnett square. A Punnett square is a diagram for predicting allele combinations of offspring from a cross between parents of known genotypes. Remember that for every gene, there are two alleles. And because of the law of segregation, these two alleles segregate into different gametes. So this parent one, let's say, is the tall dominant plant. This big T would segregate into this gamete, and this other big T would segregate into this gamete. Let's say that parent two is this dwarf plant. this little t would segregate into this gamete, and this little t would segregate into this gamete. So the top rows show segregation from alleles from parent 1, and the left-hand column shows segregation of alleles from parent 2. Now these boxes here show the possible offspring genotype, and you get those genotypes by pairing up the allele from this parent with the allele from this parent, and so on and so forth. That's what these arrows are showing. To study this gene of pea plant height, let's have a look at three generations of monohybrid crosses. In the parental generation, a tall pea plant is crossed with a dwarf pea plant. The tall pea plant is homozygous dominant, meaning the dominant big T segregated in all of their gametes. So a big T goes into this gamete, and another big T goes into this gamete. The dwarf pea plant is homozygous recessive, meaning that the recessive small t segregated into all of their gametes also. So a small t goes here, and this other small t goes into this gamete. When the big and little t combine during fertilization, all the F1 generation offspring in the green get the heterozygous genotype of the big T and the little t alleles. So when this big T and this little t fertilize, they result in this heterozygous phenotype. When this big T and this little t fertilize, they result in this heterozygous phenotype, and the same goes on for this row here. So let's look at the genotype and the phenotype ratios of the F1 generation offspring. So the genotype ratio, the ratio of possible allele combinations for the F1 generation, is that there are 0 big T, big T offspring, 4 big T, little t offspring, and 0 little t offspring. But the phenotype ratio, the ratio of physical features we see, are 4 tall plants and 0 dwarf plants. It's really important that you understand the difference between genotype and phenotype ratios. When these F1 generation peas are self-pollinated, or they're crossed against each other, they produce two kinds of gametes because they're heterozygous. So either the big T would separate into one of the gametes, or the small t would separate into one of the gametes. Same goes for the egg. A big T would go into this gamete, and a small t, a little t, would go into this gamete. When these F1 generation offspring are mated with each other, the possible genotypes of their offspring can be predicted by this Punnett square. So the orange is denoting the F2 generation. On the top row of this Punnett square, we see that the big T of parent 1 segregates into this gamete, the little t from parent 1 segregates into this gamete. In this left-hand column, we see that the big T from parent 2 segregates into this gamete, and the little t from parent 2 segregates into this gamete. If the gametes combine, these are the possible genotypes. If the genotype is big T, big T, the phenotype will be a tall pea plant. If the genotype is big T, little t, the phenotype will still be a tall pea plant because the tall big T allele is dominant to the dwarf little t allele. But if the genotype is little t, the phenotype will be a dwarf pea plant. Let's look at the genotype ratio of this F2 generation. The ratio of possible allele combinations is that there is 1 big T offspring, 2 big T little t offspring, and 1 little t offspring. But the phenotype ratio is that there are 3 tall pea plant offspring and 1 dwarf pea plant offspring. I'd like you to get more experience with analyzing these monohybrid crosses, so let's have a look at another example. Here, we are looking at a new set of pea plants, but this time we're looking at the gene or the trait for pea color. In this parental generation, a yellow pea plant is crossed with a green pea plant. The yellow pea plant is homozygous dominant, meaning the dominant big Y segregated in all of their gametes. The green pea plant is homozygous recessive, meaning that the recessive small y allele segregated in all of their gametes. When the big Y and the little y combine during fertilization, all of the F1 generation offspring get the heterozygous genotype of big Y and little y. When these F1 generation peas create their own gametes, they produce two kinds of gametes. Either the big Y would segregate into this gamete, or the little Y would segregate into this gamete. And now, when these F1 generation offspring are mated with each other, or when they're cross-pollinated, the possible genotypes of their offspring can be predicted by this Punnett square. On the top row of this Punnett square, we see a big Y allele from parent 1, and we see a little Y allele from parent 1 segregating into this gamete. On the left-hand column, we see a big Y allele from parent 2 segregating into this gamete, and we see a little Y allele from parent 2 segregating into this gamete. The genotype ratio of the F2 offspring, so the ratio of possible allele combinations, is that there is one homozygous dominant, big Y, there are two heterozygous individuals, big Y, little Y, and there is one homozygous recessive individual, little y. But when we look at the phenotype ratio, the ratio of physical features we see, there are three yellow pea plants and there is one green pea plant. But there will also be situations where we have an individual with a dominant phenotype but an unknown genotype. For example, let's say we have a mystery pea plant that has yellow seeds. We can't tell from the pea color if this plant is homozygous dominant for yellow, so big Y, or if it's heterozygous with big Y, little y. This is because both genotypes, big Y, result in the same yellow pea phenotype. So to determine the genotype of this mystery pea plant, we can cross this plant with a homozygous recessive with a genotype of little y, and it's going to be a green pea plant. This kind of cross is called a test cross. A test cross is used to determine the genotype of a phenotypically dominant individual that has an unknown genotype. If the test cross produces an F1 generation that all have the dominant phenotype, like in this scenario, the mystery individual must be homozygous dominant. But if the test cross produces an F1 generation where 50% of the peas had the dominant phenotype, but the other 50% of the peas had the recessive green phenotype, then the mystery individual must be heterozygous. Now, it's absolutely unethical and impractical to carry out these monohybrid or test crosses on people. It's because it's unethical to ask pairs of humans to breed so that the phenotypes of their offspring could be analyzed. And also, humans produce a low number of offspring compared with the common organisms we use in the lab. So instead, geneticists analyze the results of matings that have already occurred, and they do this by collecting information about a family's history for a particular trait and assembling this information into a family tree. This family tree describes the traits of parents and children across several generations, and the diagram produced is called a pedigree chart. When reading a pedigree chart, it's important to know the following conventions. So a square on the pedigree chart indicates a male individual, and a circle on the pedigree chart indicates a female individual. In this pedigree chart, they've shaded in the affected individuals. Sometimes this could be a disease, but in this case, it's just the dominant trait, which is widow's peak. Another annotation you should note about is this horizontal line between two individuals. This represents a mating event. So this male has mated with this female, and the line going down and the horizontal line shows the offspring. So this couple has produced 1, 2, 3, 4 offspring. And this fourth offspring here has mated with this individual, and together they have produced 1, 2 offspring. Here is another pedigree chart that I have drawn. This one follows the recessive albinism mutation in a family. Here you can see the grandparents, Bill and Pam. They have 4 children, Don, Jill, Jane, and Karen. Karen has 4 children with Brian, and their children are Lloyd, Sam, Bridget, and Anne. We notice here that Sam is an albino male. If you haven't heard of albinism before, it's a genetic condition where there is no dark pigment in the skin, hair, and eyes. And in this picture, the girl does not have albinism, but this boy here has inherited the mutation that causes albinism. So he does not have dark pigmentation on his skin, hair, and his eyes. So where did Sam get albinism from? Because neither Karen nor Brian, his parents, have it. Well, it's important to realize that when a child is different from both their parents, that child must be recessive. The allele must have been present in his parents, but not expressed because a dominant allele was present. So it's very likely that Karen and Brian were heterozygous and masked the trait of albinism. We see that Sam's grandfather, Bill, also had albinism, but this albinism trait skipped a generation. It's important to know that only recessive traits can skip a generation, whereas dominant traits, on the other hand, are always seen and they can't skip a generation. Awesome, you've reached the end of this lesson. So by now you should be able to use Punnett squares to predict the result of monohybrid crosses, identify the expected phenotypic and genotypic ratios of monohybrid crosses using Punnett squares, explain the usefulness of test crosses in determining the genotype of a given individual, and be able to use pedigree charts to identify the probable genotype or phenotype of a given individual. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.